Hi, everybody, and welcome to our English for the Workplace Facebook Live. I'm joined, as usual, by Jenny and David. Hello, both of you.
Hello, everyone.
You're still on mute, Jenny.
Okay. Hello, everybody.
That's why I do the hello at the beginning, just to check. Okay, and we'll be here for the next half hour or so to answer all of your questions about looking for work, applying for jobs, writing cover letters and CVs, starting work in a new company, lots of stuff, anything like that, using English in the workplace. And this is to support our free online course on FutureLearn, which is available right now. And you know, Jenny will tell you a little bit more about that in a moment. But basically, to get started, just say hello, tell us where you're watching from, and then ask us any questions that you have about using English at work or for looking for work. But to begin with, Jenny, tell us a little bit about the course and what's happening.
Okay, well, this course is aimed at anybody who works, whether you're looking for work or whether you're looking for a new job or whether you're wanting tips about how to get on in your current job. It covers 4 weeks. So basically, we're looking at this week in week one, we're looking at finding a job. So how to decide what kind of job it is you want to do, and then how to find out about job opportunities. And then we look at the application procedure, so writing a CV and a cover letter. Next week, we look at job interviews. And then week three covers getting settled down in a job and what you need to know to you know, make a good start in the workplace. Whereas fourth week of the course covers working with people. Mm-hmm. So it's a really comprehensive look at the world of work, basically. And it's also a strong language focus as well. So a great way to develop your English skills.
Okay. And as you mentioned, I mean, it's just been a few days that you've been moderating and answering people's questions. What are some of the things people have been talking about so far?
Well, people there's been some good discussions about what people are good at doing. So a big part of this week is looking at the skills you have, and then matching them up to your likes and dislikes and the kind of job you'd like to do. So there's been lots of interesting discussions where people find on the step they have skills in common. So lots of good, interesting little discussions there. Also, lots of really good tips on the how to find jobs step. So many people are talking about the importance of social media in finding work. And I think this is definitely agree that social media is an amazing way to find job opportunities in so many different fields. And it's really valuable. So lots of people have been sharing their insights into that.
Okay, great. Bear with me for just 1 second. We've got people joining us from all over. Let me just talk about some of the countries that we've got already. Hold on. Lots of people saying hello, but from Tunisia, we have Vietnam, we have Italy, Morocco, Angola, Argentina, Algeria, Bangladesh, India, Peru, Brazil, and lots more. Okay, that's good. Okay, let me start straight away into something. I've got a question here, which just basically is from Abhinash Shah, who's just saying, is this chargeable or free, and what's the time schedule? David can answer that one, I think.
Yes, it's free. This course is 100% free. And in terms of time schedule, well, you can join now. It's, as Jenny was just explaining, it's a 4-week course, but that's if you take it in the schedule as is designed. Mm-hmm. But in fact, one of the great things about these courses is you can do it in the time that suits you. So some people might want to go really fast to do everything in 1 week. Probably not the best way if you really want to take in all the information, but it's possible if you want to. Others take longer. A few minutes every day, I think, is what we'd recommend. And that way you would go through the course at roughly, the pace that we're recommending.
Yeah. And that's the great thing. It's broken down into small steps. So you can do as little or as much as you want every day. You can go on and just do one step, which, like you say, may take 10 minutes, 5 minutes, or you can spend a little bit longer. And I think that also answers this question from Fung Tu Kwa, who's saying, can I know the timetable? So as David mentioned, you can start right now, and then it's really up to you. There, you know, there will always be new comments, new questions, new discussions for you to join in. You can do it after work, you can do it before work, you can do it anytime at the weekend, anytime that you want. Okay. More people joining us from Serbia, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Uzbekistan, Korea, Thailand. So we're certainly covering a wide range of countries today in our audience. That's great. Okay, let's start with some of the questions that we've been asked this week. First of all, from Iman Monier. Obviously, over the last couple of years, there's been nothing but online interviews for more people. But just in general, online interviews are becoming more common, I think, for lots of work. And it's a bit different from face-to-face interviews, isn't it? So what would you say about this question, Jenny?
Well, first of all, I would say, yes, it is different, but there are also similarities. And I think a key similarity and something which we cover in week two of the course is the importance of preparation. So loads of preparation, having a look at your CV beforehand, having a look at the person specification. So that's the document which shows you what the company are looking for, what the position requires, and thinking about how your skills and abilities and qualifications match the requirements of the job. So that's exactly the same, and that's something that you really need to do. You also need to practice, just like with a face-to-face interview, you know, answering typical job interview questions like, tell me about yourself. That's something else we cover in the course. Mm-hmm. Now, the differences are that really impressions are always very important in a job interview. And in an online interview, the impression you make is really based on what the interviewer sees and hears on the screen. So you need to make sure that you look good as you can. And I mean, with the online interviews, that means spending a lot of time on the bits that can be seen. So the great news is you don't need to go out and buy a new pair of shoes. You do need to work on your hair, maybe your makeup. And you know, wear something smart on your top half. But
you would recommend wearing something on the bottom half, I suppose.
Well, that's really up to you. I'll leave that up to our viewers to decide. Anyway, you also need to work on your background. So that's really important. You know, choose wherever you are, wherever you're having the interview, choose somewhere that is you know, looks okay. You don't want to have your dirty washing hanging on in the background. If you really can't find anywhere in your house that, you know, presents a professional looking background, then do consider, you know, you can get some quite nice backgrounds, you know, kind of like filter backgrounds, and choose something sensible and professional looking rather than a desert island background, for example. Very important that people are able to hear what you're saying. So you need to make sure your sound is working properly. Consider doing a test call with a friend before you have your online interview so that you know that you can be heard clearly. I'd recommend doing this anyway because it's just a good idea. Your friend could maybe give you feedback as well on how you look and on how your background is as well. So yeah, I'd say for the online interview, that's really the key differences. I'd also, you know, technology can and does go wrong sometimes. So the other thing I'd suggest is make sure that you have a kind of plan B. Okay. Just in case your planning goes wrong. So, you know, maybe have another device lined up that you can use, or you can make sure that the interviewer has your phone number if something happens with your internet or something, so they can call you. So yeah, that's the key things I would suggest for an online.
Lots of good advice there. And yeah, I mean, I think it's something that's, there's so much good advice there. It's probably a good idea to join the course if people are listening, just so they can get all of this, you know, in writing as well, to kind of help them with that. David, I just want to come to you from the point of view of, as an interviewer, because I know you've conducted lots of interviews, What's been your experience with interviewees? How have they reacted in online interviews? Do you feel it's a difference for them? Do people feel more nervous, less nervous? Do they perform better in some way? Is it easier for them? What's your kind of experience with that, you think, if you compare the two?
Yes. I think it probably depends on the person. If a lot, I mean, obviously a lot of people have also been taking part in online, you know, meetings at work or whatever these days. Mm-hmm. So I think now most people are not, shall we say, any differently behaved than before. I think one problem people still have is not necessarily taking the kind of advice Jenny was just giving. So they don't maybe think carefully enough about their background or about the sound, you know, especially how well they can be heard. So I think maybe making sure you have maybe a good microphone is very important, because probably it's not tragic if the person can't see you very well, especially if you forgot your makeup, like me again today.
For some of us,
but you know, if it's an interview, it's really important that your voice is clear, which can be both how you personally choose to speak, but it could also be how, you know, the quality is being picked up on, you know, and if you're using, as some people do, like a phone, you know, it can be that the microphone especially is not very good, or maybe if your laptop is, you know, a bit old or whatever, it doesn't have the best sound. So I think doing that practice that Jenny mentioned and finding out how easily someone can hear you, because I think that's where it can really go wrong.
Okay. So, I mean, so to sum up, I mean, basically, as Jenny was saying, the interview itself, the things you need to prepare for that are not very different, but there are some things that, I mean, you know, obviously in a face-to-face interview, you don't have to think about your background or your microphone. So technical things and presentation kind of things perhaps to think about within that, and practice, of course, as Jenny said, you know, both for technical and just practical things. Okay, got a comment here from Antonella, who's saying, in reference to, we were talking about social media earlier, be aware of scams and applying for jobs via social media. We're currently living in the world of scams and frauds. That's very good advice. I mean, I do, as you mentioned, I see lots of, in groups, adverts for jobs and people looking for jobs, and it's a great way to get direct contact for that. But I also see some people advertising jobs that are perhaps not what they appear. Okay.
Perhaps they're like trying to cross-reference the name of the company, like search it separately from the advert, which might help you decide, is it a real company, first of all? And if it is a real company, are they actually advertising the job that you've seen?
Yeah.
Okay, so many more people joining us from all over, from Sudan and Thailand and Czech Republic now. Lots of people saying how much they love English and how much they want to improve English. Okay, just bear with me for one moment. Right, okay, back to question number two. Now, this applies to both online and face-to-face interviews. I know that for myself, before job interviews, I am incredibly nervous. I don't know, you two are probably very relaxed and laid back. But what can you do about it? Is it a bad thing? Is it a good thing? Are there pluses and minuses? Is there anything you can do to control that nervousness or to reduce it in some way? Jenny?
Yeah, it's normal to be a little bit nervous before a job interview, and it's good to be a little bit nervous before a job interview, because if you're nervous, your body will produce adrenaline and that will help you to perform as best as you possibly can. It's not good to be very nervous before an interview, because then you're just going to, you know, forget answers and, you know, be too frightened to perform as well as you can. So the key question then is, how can you're going to have that, hopefully, that little bit of nerves to help you perform well, but how can you stop feeling really nervous? Well, I would suggest that there are two key things to do. The first thing is try to reframe the way you think about job interviews. Job interviews are wonderful. They're wonderful learning opportunities. Whether you get the job or not, It'll be good if you get the job, probably. If it's the right job for you, that's good. But if you don't get the job, whether it's because the interview doesn't go well or whether you decide it's not the job for you, that's a great learning experience, which is going to help you in your next career move or your next job interview. So if you approach it as a learning experience and also as a negotiation, so don't think this is, it's not like an exam where you're going to be tested. Think of it a bit more like you're going to find out if they're the right fit for you and they're going to find out if you're the right fit for them. I know that can sometimes be difficult if it's a job you're really desperate for, but really you don't want to end up working for a bad company that doesn't treat you right, that doesn't give you the conditions you deserve. So try to alter your thinking. The second key thing is preparation. You need to prepare really, really well. So many interview nerves come from just not being well enough prepared, from not knowing enough about, you know, from not being able to answer questions. There are some difficult questions you can get at interviews, but the vast majority of questions you'll be asked in the interview will be questions that you should have been able to prepare for. For example, the tell me about yourself question, the what can you bring to this company question. All of these questions, there's no reason on earth why you shouldn't be well prepared to speak about these. You should be able to predict the kind of questions that you will be asked for and prepare for them. And finally, it's little things you can do a couple of days before the interview. Check exactly how long it's going to take you to get there, because you don't want to arrive late because you've misjudged the time and then you'll be all sweaty and anxious and stressed out. That will make you nervous, so make sure that doesn't happen. And yeah, things like have a good breakfast on the day, listen to some relaxing music to get you in the mood. Okay. That's all to help.
Excellent and comprehensive advice there. I think Jenny's covered so much there. I'm not sure there's anything left for you, David. But, and let's, these are all really, I mean, preparation, I think, mm-hmm. is going to be something we're yes. going to talk about, you know, with every question, that preparation is the most mm-hmm. important thing. Are there any other, I mean, let's imagine we've done all the things Jenny said. We've mm-hmm. prepared, we've checked our route to the job interview, we've mm-hmm. arrived half an hour early, everything is there, and we're waiting to go into the interview, and we're still feeling really nervous. Is there anything that we can do then, you think?
I think, sometimes just simple things like maybe taking, you know, some deep breaths to try and calm yourself. Maybe if you have notes with you, which I think something that would be a very good idea, having good a quick point. Look at your notes to remind yourself of key things. I mean, especially now if we're thinking about doing it in English and that's not your first language, maybe just reminding yourself of some key words mm-hmm. that you need to use during the interview. And I think, yeah, I think one of the things Jenny said is don't see it as a test. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's, you know, it's not pass or fail. I mean, even if you don't get the job, that doesn't necessarily mean you did a bad interview. It could just be, unfortunately, there was a slightly better candidate, yeah. you know, or they just happen to have a little bit of experience that you don't have. Well, okay, if you got the job, you get the experience. So it can be a vicious circle, as we say. But, you know, try not to wind yourself up that this is going to be a really terrible situation. You know, try to relax and be positive about what's going to happen.
Yeah,
I'm just going to pick up on a couple of things you said there, because I think they're really useful, and it's mm-hmm. something that we didn't mention about, because we're talking about being nervous. Now, you mentioned about like cards or notes or something mm-hmm. like that, and you also mentioned about the fact that obviously for our audience, they're going to be, we're talking about perhaps an interview in English mm-hmm. and it's their second language. Let's talk a little bit more about that. Cards, I mean, I'm not sure that everyone does this. I think it's a great idea, mm-hmm. but what would you say about that, either one of you? You know,
well, first of all, it's something I think it was particularly relevant maybe to the interview on the online interview that we have, something I forgot to mention mm-hmm. earlier, because it might depend on the company whether they allow you to have notes or any kind of cards with you in a face-to-face interview. But they can't stop you if you're sitting at home, because they don't see. Mm-hmm. So, you know, basically, like Jenny was saying, there are certain questions that you can predict are going to be asked. You don't want to prepare line by line everything you're going to say, because you will sound like a robot just reading off a script mm-hmm. and that will not come across well. But you can make notes of key things you want to mention, keywords, you know, if you, again, especially if you want to support yourself with language, you know, I must use this word, I must use this word, I want to use this expression to introduce a new idea, etc. And this can really give you something just to look at. You know, you can have them to the side of your screen, perhaps, or even on another tab if it's an electronic document on your computer. Mm-hmm. And you can just flick between them looking for the thing that you want to say. And you can also use this for the fact you can have different examples that might be relevant depending on what question you're asked. And I think this is the other way to do it. Mm-hmm. I actually had to do an interview myself recently, and that was the main part of my preparation was just thinking of examples of things I have done and how that would connect to a skill. Like, what's my best example of team working? What's my best example of helping a colleague or whatever? And try to write those down with some key words and phrases.
Very good advice there. And just about the English question, Jenny, I mean, I guess it's like it's a bit like going for something like a test, like an IELTS test or something like that. If you're not using English every day before you go for the interview and you're going into the interview in English, you know, that's an added kind of stress. What about kind of warming up in the days before or something like that with English? What could you say about that?
Yeah, well, this is where, you know, well, there's a couple of options. Practicing with an English-speaking friend is a good idea. You know, it doesn't have to be, it can be an English learner as well. It doesn't need to be someone with perfect English, just someone who basically understands what you're saying, practicing and getting some feedback for them, from them. But also just recording yourself on your phone and listening back to your performance and thinking about how you sound, talking to yourself in front of the mirror so you get the whole sort of facial expressions thing going on as well is a really good idea too. So yeah, these are three good ways of and different ways of practicing.
Lots of great advice there. It all falls under the umbrella, I guess, of preparation and prepare. But there's so many ways that you can prepare to really help yourself, mm-hmm. and that will reduce your nerves. Okay, great. Josephine Katchi has got a comment here, which I think in any interview, the best thing to do is to be oneself and answer any technical questions mm-hmm. according to one's knowledge. Can't argue with that, really. I think.
Yes. I mean, ultimately, they are employing you as the human being you are. If they like you, they will probably offer you a job. If they don't like you, well, better you find out now than later, you know?
Okay. Hold on. Bear with me. Just scrolling through all the new comments. Right, I'll move on to another question while, because there's a question I want to find, but I lost it in the excitement there. This, I think, is an excellent and very interesting question from Nagla Lotfi. Many companies refuse my CV or reject my CV or whatever, as I'm overqualified and they want someone younger. What should I do? Now, I think we can look at those separately and together. I mean, because they're two different things, but they're both equally important and something to think about. But it does happen that companies will say, you know, either during the interview they might say, don't you feel you're overqualified for this job, or they might say after the interview, you know, you did very well, but we feel you're overqualified for this job. So let's think about why they say that and what you can do about it. If we can, which of you would like to say a little bit about the overqualified one first?
I can try a little
bit. Go for it.
I think one thing we've mentioned in previous conversations like this one is about making your CV relevant to the job you've applied for. So maybe this is an example where you maybe have mentioned every single qualification that you've got, every piece of experience you've got. And as a result, you look like someone, you know, who is too good for the job. So try to tailor your CV so you're mentioning only those things that are relevant to the job you're applying for. Now, you might feel that you're kind of being a little bit untruthful here, but I think by omitting things that are true is not the same as making things up, which is a very big thing you should not do. So I think this is the first step, maybe, is tailor your CV to the job you're applying for and only mention relevant qualifications. And I think a second thing you can do here at this stage is when you're writing your cover letter. that you send in with your CV, you may want to address this issue and get it out of the way and say, well, you know, because presumably there is a reason why you're going for these jobs, even though yourself, you may feel you're overqualified. Maybe you're looking for a slightly different direction in your career. Well, explain that in your cover letter, or if you've already got to the interview, explain that in the interview. And explain, and if maybe the age is the same thing, explain why, okay, maybe I'm older than what you're looking for, but, you know, I've got these, you know, that can be a strength, obviously, you're bringing experience.
I'm going to keep for a separate part, because I think there's some really interesting things to say about that, like you just said there. Yeah. I'm going to say a little bit more about the overqualified part first. Mm-hmm. Jenny, I mean, as David was just saying there, you know, this... The interview is one part, but this is someplace where the value of the cover letter really comes into its own. Would you say for the overqualified part?
Yeah. I think so. I mean, I think what David said was really important about how you should say, you know, why you're maybe making this change, but also really emphasize like why you want this job. This particular job, so that everybody, I think, likes to feel special. And I think recruiters are no exception to this. So, you know, they don't want to feel like, you know, they're just maybe being settled for by somebody who maybe, you know, couldn't stand the pace of the last job they worked
That's
at.
That's a good point. So, that's one thing I want to ask you. But I mean, what you know, you would think employers want the, you know, the most qualified person. Why do they say people are overqualified? What is their thinking? What's the concern of employers? That's exactly. So, mm-hmm. So yeah, tell me more about that. That's interesting.
Well, part of it, I suppose, might be they might be anxious that the person might want higher fee or a higher wage than they're prepared to give them. But yeah, part of it might be that they don't understand why does this person mm-hmm. want to work for me? You know, were they not able to deal with the demands of their last job? Or, you know, they just are human. They just want to know the reason. You know, recruiters are just like everyone else. They just want to know why you may be applying for this job. So I think it's just making yourself really, really clear why you've chosen this job, and always with all you know, cover letters and CVs, mm-hmm. use positive language as well. Mm-hmm. Always be emphasizing the positive, not why you're leaving this career behind you, but why you're really emphasizing why you've chosen this mm-hmm. new direction. And also, just to add on to something that David was saying, think about transferable skills. So it's maybe not necessarily about leaving things out, it's repurposing mm-hmm. them. So what skills did you have in this job, did you use in this job, that are also going to be useful for the job you're applying for? And if you can really highlight this skill, all the skills that you're going to bring to this job, and you can highlight your interest and passion in the job you're applying for, then you know, that might get you better results.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great advice there. And I guess going back to something else you said, I mean, practice. This is something that has happened to you before that you know happens, this is perhaps something mm-hmm. you can practice for that in the interview, you know, how you can communicate your reason, you know, the enthusiasm, the reasons, mm-hmm. all the things like that you can really prepare for to show yourself in the best light. Okay, I'm going to go back to David for the age question now, because as an old man, I feel this question deeply myself. So I'm looking mm-hmm. for your advice mm-hmm. on this. It does happen. It shouldn't happen. And of course, in many companies and many countries, there's laws, legislation, mm-hmm. which is designed to prevent age discrimination. But mm-hmm. of course, you know, it does happen in some places and in some jobs in some way. What should we say about that? You started to talk about it a little earlier, so you know, if you have that feeling, that's a problem.
Mm. I mean, one thing that which I was trying to say earlier is trying to turn it into a positive, to say that, okay, I'm older than you maybe are ideally looking for, but I can bring experience. You know, I know how to work with people because I have actually done the job. Maybe a younger person hasn't actually done this kind of work before, and you're going to spend a long time training them how to do it. So you have to try and sell that as a positive, that you have skills that maybe the other person is lacking due to their age. As you said, Neil, also there could be the, you know, in certain countries this would be illegal anyway, so hopefully it would not happen. But I think it might also be something where you maybe need to look carefully at what the job actually is. And there may be a reason why that they're expecting a younger person. It could be a very, it kind of connects to the CV question, I guess, here as well, that it could be that this is a very junior position where actually they're expecting someone who maybe comes straight from school even, and you're coming with 10, 20 years experience. It's a little bit strange that you want this job. And as Jenny was saying, you would, at the very least, you need to explain why you want it. Because it seems like you're too good for this job, that you should be aiming higher. So why are you not a little bit more ambitious would be something that somebody would might want to know in this situation. So, you know, I think it's a difficult one because obviously you can't change your age. You are the age you are. And sooner or later, they are going to find out if should you try to mask it in some way. But I think maybe try to deal with the best one is for me would be to deal with it positively.
It's an interesting point because we have a slightly strange question here, perhaps from Love Air, which is there any possibility of cheating in an online interview? Neil should answer. I'm not sure. I'm not sure what they know about my about. But yeah, obviously, you know, in any job interview, I would be using Instagram filters to make myself look 20 years younger, cheating. Okay, I'm going to answer this question anyway. No, I don't, an interview is an interview. That it's up to the interviewer to conduct it in a professional way, which prevents that. But as David mentioned earlier, there are some things that perhaps you can help yourself with in an online interview that you couldn't do in a face-to-face interview. David's mentioning earlier about having all the possible examples there, you know, to kind of draw on in front of you. You know, I did actually do this once before, like post-it notes on the wall with every possible example, just so I wouldn't have to think about it too long. It's not cheating. It's making the most of the opportunity.
But I think if you're thinking of more serious type, I mean, I would say that's helping yourself, not cheating. But
yeah, exactly.
If you're actually trying to cheat, I mean, there's an obvious point. You shouldn't do it, but also because you will be found out sooner or later because, you know, a company is going to ask you to submit documents afterwards. You know, maybe it's not enough to submit your CV. You'll probably have to give evidence of your qualifications and other work experience, etc. And, you know, at some point somebody's going to go, well, hang on, this is not at all who you said you were, as it were. So,
Okay, popular question now from Mohammed Fahim. How to answer about your weaknesses? It's one of the most popular interview questions. Something like, so what's your greatest weakness? Jenny, I'm not asking you. I'm just. how do you approach this question? We were talking about preparation. How could you prepare for this question to have a good answer ready?
Okay, so. Yeah, you need to choose something. You need to choose a weakness which you have. Be honest. It's a good opportunity to think about the things you do well and the things you don't do so well. The key thing to answering this question successfully is that you need to choose a weakness which you are taking steps to improve. And you need to talk about the steps that you are taking to improve this weakness. So for example, maybe your weakness is you really get really nervous about public speaking, for example. So then you could talk about maybe, this is my weakness is I get really nervous before public speaking. But then you would talk about what steps you were taking. So you could say, "Oh, but I'm currently taking a course in public speaking, or I have I've volunteered with my local debating society, and I've confronted my fears, and I'm starting to find it a little bit easier, although it's still challenging." So it's fine to admit that it's it's still an issue. It wouldn't be a weakness if you were totally over your fear of public speaking. It maybe doesn't come naturally to you, but you're working on it.
Okay.
I think the other thing to point out, though, is that do try to choose a weakness which isn't a completely central skill to the job you're applying for. So, if you're going for a job as a secretary, don't say that your weakness is paperwork. you're probably not going to get the job. You know, you need to be strong in the areas they really want. So choose something that's maybe a little bit peripheral.
Okay, good. Good advice there. I'm not going to ask David the same question, because I'm going to go on to an associated question from Jasmine Pallian, which is how to answer the question, what's your biggest accomplishment? So the opposite end of the spectrum, your biggest weakness. Now, what's your greatest accomplishment? Or could be something like, what's the thing you're most proud of? Or, you know, something like that. What's what, you know, what was a major achievement in your last work? Something like that. What about this one?
Well, I think the first thing is to make sure that you talk about work, because I can imagine a lot of people would be tempted to talk about, you know, bringing up my two beautiful children or something like this, which is fantastic. If you have two beautiful children, you should be proud of it, but it's not the thing maybe for a job interview, I think you need to find an example that would be relevant to what you're, the job you're being interviewed for in the best possible scenario, that you probably have several things you have done well at work. So actually, let's stop and think about that. For many people, if they're asked this question, might think, actually, I've never done anything. Or, you know, I just turn up at work, I do my job. If you're Neil, you might think, I don't even manage that.
I feel like every question is directed at me.
So actually, let's stop for a moment and think about the fact that this is where I think preparation matters, because it is a predictable question.
Yeah.
And you might instinctively think, I do nothing special in my job. I don't have these accomplishments, never mind a big one, you know. So actually writing down some things you could say, right, I did that well. Oh, I remember last year, you know, my manager said that I did this job particularly well. So maybe have some examples and then try to narrow those down to ones that are connected to the job that you're applying for, so that you could give an example of, I don't know, you know, the second job that Jenny mentioned, where you did the paperwork very effectively, and as a result, you know, the company was able to, let's say, submit an order on time or something like that.
Okay, so it's good to talk about that. And that we talk about this in the course as well, about the way of preparing an answer like that, to talk about what it was, what the situation was, what you did, and what the result was, to kind of structure an answer like that. Okay, very good advice there. And I think for both of these, as you both said, I mean, these are, they may not come up, they may not be asked, but they're possible questions. And if you don't prepare, you're basically just, you know, damaging you. If somebody asked me that right now, I would struggle to think of what it is. It would take me 10 minutes to think, okay, what is it? You know, so, you know, to prepare is absolutely essential for these. Okay, very good advice. We're almost out of time. So I'm just going to quickly rattle through a couple more things. Question from Kelly. This is a good question, I think, because a lot of people, I mean, everyone, you know, has the experience of their first ever serious interview. And, you know, it's always going to be difficult. And Kelly's saying, so imagine, you know, you're a student, or you're just finishing university or whatever. Maybe you've done some small part-time jobs or something before, but this is your very first interview with no experience, no work experience, and no experience of a real serious interview. What maybe are the things to think about just for that? Jenny?
Well, hopefully the person who's interviewing you will realise the stage that you're at and will have prepared questions that are appropriate for you. But things to think about are, how can you link the skills that they are looking for in this job with your experience, not of work, but of things that you have done. So, for example, you know, at school, university, think about skills you might have gained through being involved in free time activities. Sports, if you've been involved in sports, that's always a great thing to talk about, because you can use your your time working, you know, your time spent working as a team, that people are always interested in hearing about that. So you can talk about teamwork and present teamwork through these experiences. But if you're not sporty, and many people aren't, you might have been involved in similar things like drama clubs, for example, or even you might have had a part-time job, or you might have volunteered. And again, there's many different skills that you would have developed as a result of these activities. So really just, you know, make a mind map or something of all the things you've done in your life, and then think about all of the skills you might have gained through these different activities, and come along prepared to speak about them at interview. And you know, you should have plenty to talk about.
Okay. We're out of time. So anything you'd like to add to that, David, or?
Well, I think the fact that you're listening to, you know, taking part in the event like this one, or if you're on our course, will help you be aware of the kind of things you might get asked at interview. And as a result, you can prepare in the way that Jenny's saying. So I think, and maybe search a few other websites with example questions so that you can, you know, obviously, if you've never been interviewed, you might not know what they're going to ask you. You might not imagine. So, you know, make sure you've checked the kind of questions that typically pop up.
Yeah, I think it's a good point. I mean, especially if you've never had an interview, this course is perfect for you because it will give you so much information that perhaps you have not thought about before or are not aware of before. So it's definitely something to think about. Okay, I'm just going to finish with one last point. Yeah, I'm just going to say this one because Anis has asked a question. If I told them I haven't got any weakness, does that make them know I'm confident or a liar? How to convince you? Okay, my only everyone has a weakness. Don't say that. That's not going to come across as confident. It's going to come across as
I think the same is true for the other one. You know, the positive one about accomplishments, you must have a weakness. You must have something you've achieved. It suggests lack of self-awareness if you don't.
Okay, that's us over for today. Fantastic answers from both of you. Lots of great questions coming in. Any final words? David first.
Well, come and join us on the course if you're not already there. And if you are there, keep up the good work. See you on the course.
Jenny?
I couldn't have put it better myself. Yeah. Keep commenting and keep joining in the discussions. And see you back on the course.
Okay. And the link to join the course you'll find in the comments. And of course, if you follow our Facebook page, we share it regularly. And hopefully we'll see you there. But thank you for all your great questions. And we'll see you again soon. Bye for now.